Good morning. I'd like to welcome members of the press and public to the second meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2016. I'd ask all those present to ensure that their electronic items are switched to flight mode so that they don't affect the work of the committee. I'm just going to move to agenda item number one, which is a decision in taking business in private. The question is that we take agenda items number six and seven in private. Are we all agreed? Move to agenda item number two, which is the Section 22 report, the 2014-15 audit of the police, Scottish Police Authority. We would like to welcome today our panel, which is Caroline Gardner, the Auditor General for Scotland, Gillian Woolman, who is the Assistant Director, and Mark Roberts, who is the Senior Manager of Audit Scotland. I understand that the Auditor General has a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and can I take this opportunity to wish the committee Happy New Year. Convener, I'm presenting this report on the 2014-15 audit of the Scottish Police Authority under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Act. 2014-15 was the second year of operation for the SPA and Police Scotland, and the SPA's accounts include the financial results of the Police Service of Scotland. I'd like to highlight two issues to the committee. The first is the appointed auditor's opinion on the SPA's 2014-15 accounts. The accounts are unqualified, but for the second year running, Gillian Woolman, who I appoint to audit the accounts, has expressed a modified conclusion on those matters on which she is required to report by exception. She concluded that adequate accounting records had not been kept during 2014-15 for some aspects of property, plant and equipment. Overall, the audit was very challenging to complete due to the poor quality of the unaudited accounts and major problems with information contained within the fixed assets register. In our experience of auditing public sector bodies, this is exceptional. The second issue is the continued lack of a long-term financial strategy for policing in Scotland. I first recommended that the SPA and Police Scotland should develop and agree a financial strategy in November 2013. I drew the Parliament's attention to the lack of progress last year in my Section 22 report on the 2013-14 accounts, and I'm doing so again now. While some progress has been made, as detailed in my report, it's been slow. The SPA now plans to agree a long-term financial strategy for the next decade by the end of March 2016. The Scottish Government's draft budget for 2016-17 provides an increase in funding for the Scottish Police Authority. This will assist in meeting some of the immediate financial pressures, but it doesn't remove the need to continue to find savings and particularly to develop and agree a long-term strategy to secure the financial sustainability of policing. Together, the SPA and Police Scotland represent one of our most important public services. In 2014-15, they spent over £1.7 billion of public money and held assets valued at more than £500 million. Collectively, they must provide stronger leadership for strategic and operational financial management if they're going to be able to put policing onto a sustainable basis for the future. Convener, I will report to Parliament again next year on the SPA's progress in managing its finances after the conclusion of the audit of the 2015-16 accounts. Alongside me are Gillian Woolman, who audits the accounts of the SPA on my behalf, and Mark Roberts, who leads on policing and justice within Audit Scotland. And as always, Convener, we'll do our best to answer questions from the committee.
Before I continue, colleagues, could I just clarify for the record that David Torrance has indicated his apologies for today's meeting. Auditor General, can I just ask, can you clarify for the record what the sum would be, the budget sum that would be allocated to Police Scotland on an annual basis?
The amount that was spent in 2014-15 was around £1.7 billion in total, so it's a lot of public money.
So would you consider then, given the scale of that public investment, that maintaining of records should be a pretty standard practice, should it not? Even in a challenging position that they find themselves in as a result of the merger.
It should be a standard practice for any public body spending public money, but as you suggest, Convener, particularly for one responsible for such large amounts of money and providing such vital public services.
So what kind of explanations would you have been given during this process for reasons why the records weren't kept to the standard that they should have?
I'll ask Gillian Woolman to talk you through that as the person responsible for carrying out the audit.
Thank you. Yes, I'm happy to respond to that particular question. Fixed assets, are now known as property, plant and equipment in the financial statements, is always a significant part of the audit for every public sector body. You'll recall last year with the statutory report on the 13-14 accounts, I already drew attention to the fact that the accounting records for property, plant and equipment was not adequate. This year, a very significant exercise was undertaken by the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland to bring all of the underlying fixed asset registers together. So if you recall, there was 10 organisations, 8 of whom were joint police forces at that time. So it was a very significant exercise to bring together all of those records. There was a new system, Asset 4000, being used, and this is a system that we are familiar with in other large public sector bodies. However, the exercise overran in terms of time. We were unable to undertake the audit work in a timely fashion. It was very late and some months after the financial year end that we undertook the audit work, and we found a number of errors when we undertook the work. We had to work very closely with officers highlighting these issues. And in fact, at one point, we withdrew from the audit for them to undertake a corrective action plan to improve their accounting records in the area of fixed assets. We returned to the audit. We carried out additional audit work, more than was planned and more than would be normally the case, in order to gain the necessary assurance about the results with respect to fixed assets by the end of the day in the financial statements.
So can I ask, because if you can understand, it's pretty, I mean, this is a technical process that you followed, obviously, as an auditor. But if you look at it from a public perspective, though, this is an organisation responsible for £1.7 billion worth of funds. I think most people would probably expect that there would be the maintenance of the kind of assets that you're referring to would be pretty basic, is it not? I mean, it's not. Is it that challenging?
We did have every expectation that we would find better accounting records this year relative to last year, and it is our expectation.
Potential loss to the public purse as a result of the poor maintenance of the records. I mean, could we be losing money as a result of this?
No.
Could there be fraud or whatever? I mean, is there?
No, as a result of our audit work, we undertake a series of audit tests to be assured as to the nature of all of the transactions, and we had no concerns with the respect to the regularity of expenditure. So that's not a criticism that we made of any potential loss.
But in terms of the lack of, I mean, the point I'm making here is that if you can't keep basic records, and it doesn't really speak volumes for the effectiveness of your organisation to make best use of the public funds available to it. So if you can't do that, then there's not much point. I mean, how do you deploy resources in the appropriate areas if you don't even know where your assets are?
Yes, certainly in our statutory, our Section 22 report, we have highlighted that it is important to keep accurate records of fixed assets because we have to ensure that they're effectively managed and protected, that they provide the necessary management information for decision makers, and also to ensure that best value is derived from those assets within the stewardship of the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland.
We bring other members, Tavi Scott.
Can I thank the Auditor General for the clarity of this report and the answers that you've already given? Is the SPA financially incompetent?
The committee may recall that I reported on the reform process back in November 2013. And at that stage, one of my major conclusions was that there was a lack of clarity in the roles of SPA and Police Scotland, particularly in relation to things like the management of finances, long-term financial planning. I think it's fair to say there has been progress in clarifying those roles and making sure there were appropriate people to carry out the functions required of them both since then. But the report you have in front of you today and the report that I produced at the end of 2013-14 demonstrates that that progress is slower than I would like to see.
Indeed, and you've already said, and the convener has already questioned, what you've described as the poor quality and incomplete nature of the audit. I mean, to me that just sounds like they're just straight incompetent. They're not up to this, are they? £1.7 billion of public money, and you've said what you've said in the report today. Why should we have any confidence in them that this is going to get any better?
In my November 2013 report, I did highlight that this is one of the most significant reform programmes we've seen since devolution, and there's no doubt that was the case. Taking 8 former regional police services, merging them into one, bringing together different accounting systems, different approaches to financial management was always going to be a challenge. And I concluded that those challenges were made more difficult by the slow progress that was made initially and the lack of clarity about the roles of the two organisations that make up policing in Scotland now. I think it's now becoming critical that the shortcomings that are outlined in my report here are genuinely addressed. There is a chance for a new start with a new chair of the authority and a new chief constable in place. But I think a financial strategy is not a nice extra to have. It's something that's critical to make sure that policing does remain financially sustainable in future.
I was warned of these at the time and had to produce a minority report to do it. But I certainly don't take any credit in saying I told you so. But some of us did say this was all what was going to happen, and it's come to pass, hasn't it? And it goes on. I mean, when will they get this right? This is 2 years now where you've produced a very clear report as to the failings of the financial failings of the SPA. Do you have any expectations that next year it'll be better?
I was encouraged by the response of SPA to my report when it was published before Christmas in accepting fully the findings that I've made and outlining their plans to move forward to really resolve these issues. And it won't be straightforward to do that. The deadline they've set themselves for the financial strategy is challenging. We're not far away from March 2016. And Gillian and Mark are watching progress closely on my behalf, as you would expect.
I'm sure that's all true. Who is responsible for this? Who ultimately is responsible?
There is an accountable officer for the SPA responsible to Parliament for the use of resources in the normal way. And the overall reform process is a complex thing which both the Chair of the Authority and the Chief Constable have responsibility for.
I'd say there is the responsibility for the lack of clarity over the positions of the SPA versus the Police Scotland itself, of course, is a government matter, isn't it? That's government's failing to provide that clarity, which is something we pointed out in November 2013.
My November 2013 report did highlight the lack of clarity then. There has been some progress since, and as the committee will know, Cabinet Secretary has asked the new chair of the SPA to carry out a review of governance, which may touch on some of these issues.
Locking the proverbial door after it's well and truly bolted. You mentioned in paragraph 11 that the accounts state that the expenditure in a number of areas accounted for 46.5 million compared to a budget of 67.5 million. And I think your report goes on to say it is not clear what the remaining £21 million was spent on. Have you been able, since your report, to find out what that £21 million was spent on?
I'll ask Gillian to come in a moment on that. As we say, of the 67 million that was covered in the annual report, it was clear what 40-odd million had been spent on. It wasn't clear about the other 21 million. Again, back in my November 2013 report, I highlighted the importance of being clear how the reform budget was being used, as well as how the core police resources were. Gillian, is there anything you'd like to add on that?
Thank you. Yes. Certainly, the accounts show that £67.5 million was spent during the year 14-15 on reform-associated activities. Only £46.5 million has been identified under specific headings, and the other £21 million, what is challenging is being unable to distinguish that expenditure from normal operational expenditure. So it was spent, but it's just difficult to distinguish it from other expenditure during the year.
When you asked the police authority to say what they spent £20 million of public money on, they couldn't tell you?
It was aggregated with normal operational expenditure and not distinguished out as something very specific associated with the reform activity.
Your auditing view, should it have been quite specific? Should it have been auditable in that sense?
I think that the management commentary on the annual accounts is an opportunity to demonstrate where specific reform monies have been used, because it was just for a finite period of 3 years, to demonstrate that that investment is achieving a specific return at a time of transition for this organisation.
I couldn't agree more. So you'll understand my suggestion that it's pretty financially... I mean, I wouldn't get away with that, and most businesses wouldn't get away with spending £20 million because they don't actually know and they can't say how they spent it. So why should this public body spending taxpayers' money get away with it?
I'll conclude, if I may, by saying, as I reported in November 2013, this was a specific budget to support reform. As Jill said, it won't be available indefinitely, and therefore it's important that it's not underpinning continuing expenditure. And because this was a major reform programme promoted, accepted by Parliament, it is important that it's clear how the reform budget is spent.
I'll finish this, committee, but would it be fair to say, Auditor General, that this is not the only example where reform budgets have been spent, vast amounts of public money have been spent on reform, and you have concluded to us on a number of other occasions across a number of other reform processes that we are not absolutely precise as to where that money was spent. It's a wonderful budget to set up if you're on the end of it and using it, isn't it?
The other example that I can recall reporting in those terms is the FE college reform. It clearly is important to demonstrate the way specific funding is used in that way. And as Jill said, it's not always easy to do that because funding is being spent on headings like staffing and investment in IT systems in the same way as it would be for day-to-day management. That's why it's important to be clear from the beginning how it will be reported.
It's just odd if you said if someone asks, the SPA asks for a budget of $67 million from the government for reform and then can't see how they spent it. Well, that's extraordinary. Does the government not care about these things? Do they not mind that $67 million or $46 million is spent and people understand that, but another $20 million just goes into a black hole and no one knows where it's gone? That's appalling waste of public money, isn't it?
I don't think I can add to what I said. Yeah. I reported in 2013
absolutely.
There should be transparency and we haven't seen it for part of the budget.
I totally agree with that.
Year.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
I think it was a couple of years ago that this committee actually took the unprecedented step under the chairmanship of Hugh Henry to write a minority report because we had very, very, very serious concerns about the SPA and about the whole merger process. I just wanted to say, Auditor General, what you've said today is you were encouraged by the response of SPA. And I have to say that in the long evidence sessions between with Vic Emery and Stephen House, etc., I remember being encouraged by what they were saying, that they had a long-term financial plan, they had a financial strategy, they had their efficiency savings all set out, convener. And 3 years later, there's still no sight of a financial strategy. So all the responses and the assurances and reassurances that we were given 3-4 years ago really they didn't mean a thing. I don't want to use the word that they lied to the committee, but what we were told was in place, convener, at that time under the chairmanship of Hugh Henry, according to your report today, in terms of the long-term financial strategy, and I'd like to ask about the efficiency savings that we were promised. According to this report, none of what they promised us was in place was actually there, and we're still looking for financial strategy and the promised efficiency savings 3 years later. would you agree with that?
I understand your concern, Mr. Scanlon. Yeah. What I was referring to was specifically the response to this report immediately before Christmas, with the new chair of the SPA accepting my findings and outlining a plan for responding to
them. To compare it to the past, yeah.
I do understand the concern. I think it's also important to say that we have seen some progress being made, but in my view that progress hasn't been rapid or wide-ranging enough to address the challenges which we know policing in Scotland faces, which was one of the drivers for reform in making sure that it remains financially sustainable in a time of tight resources and growing demands on policing. And that's why it's so important to have a robust financial strategy that demonstrates how that circle will be squared.
My point is that 3 years later, what we were told was in place 3 years ago, we're still looking for it.
Progress has been slow. My report certainly says that, and it's not now in place. You're absolutely right.
I think what I'm concerned about is in paragraph one, the accounts incomplete and poor quality, you do use the word that this is exceptional. I mean, how bad is this? How exceptional is this in terms of the public sector? That's quite a guarded word to use.
It is extremely unusual. As the committee knows, I appoint the auditors of every public body in Scotland outside the local government sector. We every year take stock of the experience of doing the audits of the quality of financial reporting and financial management, and it is exceptional to find a case like this where, as Jill has described, she had to suspend the audit, go away and allow time for the SPA to correct the problems in its accounts before she could go back and do the audit work. That's very unusual.
Despite correcting the work that they were doing, we still got $21 million unaccounted for.
We don't have a breakdown of that $21 million of the reform budget and Jill's modified
her opinion. My final question, convener. Having been here I think most parties, perhaps apart from Tavish's, actually supported the merger process, and we supported it in terms that there would be more frontline policing, there would be more sharing of resources, more sharing of expertise, we would have economies of scale in procurement, and we would have better estate management. Now, what we find, I'm actually struggling to find the efficiency savings that were promised, but what I would like to just highlight is the overspend for this financial year of 25.3 million. And also on paragraph 14, you talk about you could deliver revenue savings and one-off capital receipts of 22 to 34 million. So if there was reasonable financial management, I appreciate it's capital receipt and it's a non-recurring saving. But, I mean, my concern is there's an overspend of 25 million. They could have a capital receipt that could wipe out that overspend, at least for this year. And my concern is the frontline policing and maintaining the police numbers in future, given this. I mean, where does the money come from for a 25 million overspend? It could come from the capital receipt. It's unlikely to because of the poor financial management. So where will it come from, and where is the efficiency savings that we were all promised? And that was the reason we gave it our vote.
I'll ask Mark to talk you through our current understanding of the financial position, where efficiencies have come from, and what we know about plans for the future. Mark.
In terms of the long-term savings, which were proposed to reach 1.1 billion by the end of 2025-26, the existing kind of savings made to date in terms of running costs, if extrapolated out, would contribute towards meeting those long-term savings. What, of course, that, as the committee may recall, is there were additional cost pressures built in, which were not taken into account in the initial plans. And so those still exist, and additional savings will have to be found. As the Auditor General has made reference to previously, there are additional kind of pressures on policing in terms of new demands, which are all very well publicised. And so that will create more cost pressures in the long term. So that ultimate 1.1 billion saving will probably need to be greater in order to reconcile those various factors. In terms of the current year, in terms of the £25 million projected overspend, that figure comes from an update that was provided to the SPA in October. Currently, our understanding is that the SPA and Police Scotland are working hard to work out how they can resolve that within the course of the current year. And that will, of course, be a focus for the 2015-16 audit that Gillian and her team will conduct.
So, sorry, Convener, will they have to go to government for brokerage in order to, like the NHS, if they overspend their budget, is it the same process for the police? Do they have to get a loan from government to cover the shortfall?
I think the SPA has been very clear that they're very, very determined to make sure that they will be able to kind of deliver a balanced budget by the end of the financial year.
Overspend of 25.3 million, there will be cutbacks and efficiency savings between October and April to get rid of that projected overspend, and they will balance their budget by end of March.
The SPA asked officers to go back and work out a plan in order to be able to deliver a balanced budget by the end of the financial year.
Thank you, Convener. In general, it's a disappointing report, although there's obviously some progress being made, but not far from quickly enough. And I would like to come back to what Tavish Scott spoke about, which is, has the structure, the structure of the finance area been properly put in place? Is it adequate? Does it work?
I'll ask Jill to talk you through her views of that. She's much closer to the workings of the finance function in both SPA and Police Scotland, and has engaged with the Audit Committee of the SPA over time about her views on that. Jill.
Thank you. As the Auditor General highlighted earlier, back at the time of the November 2013 reform report, we were still observing and reporting that the corporate services area was areas subject to much discussion and deliberation before settling on a particular structure. There are finance functions in both Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland. And at part of the time, clearly, the authority is there holding Police Scotland to account. But for the purpose of the preparation of the financial accounts, there is but one set of financial accounts. This is led by the Scottish Police Authority in the preparation, and the Chief Constable of Police Scotland must cooperate for the preparation of those financial statements. There are clearly very significant systems within the control of Police Scotland, where 98% of the spend is processed, but nevertheless it's the accountable officer of the SPA who's ultimately accountable for all of the spend, for all of the 1.7 billion. We have reported in our long form report to the Scottish Police Authority that there are tensions in those structures and processes, but nevertheless, we would have expected them to have worked better for the purpose of preparing quality financial statements to be presented to external audit, and for the smooth running of the external audit, and for a completely clean, unqualified audit opinion on those financial statements. So there are clearly tensions with that structure. In terms of the response to the statutory report, which the Auditor General for Scotland received at the end of December 2015, it was clear that the Scottish Police Authority are putting an interim Chief Finance Officer into place to assist with progressing and improving processes going forward. And I believe that's to address some of those tensions in the structure.
Chief Financial Officers or whatever before, wasn't there a whole series of them, and wasn't that a problem in the past?
Yes, we reported in our, at the conclusion of the 2013-14 audit, specifically in the Scottish Police Authority, there was a series of interim directors of finance for the Scottish Police Authority. The information that's been intimated to us in December 2015 is that there will be an interim Chief Finance Officer, which is a role which is senior to both the two Directors of Finance in SPA and Police Scotland, with a number of priorities, one of which is to address the projected deficit through to March 2016, and another area is for the improvement of the accounting records.
Isn't this just adding another layer of management? You know, previous layer of management didn't work. Put somebody above them and see if it works then.
It certainly is an additional post in relation, as in addition, as Jill said, to the two directors of finance in the SPA and in Police Scotland. I think the rationale is that it's there to deal with the specific short-term challenges that the policing service faces at the moment, and to carry through to the implementation of the governance review, which the new chair of the SPA is carrying out.
Now, you say in the report here in paragraph 24 that the SPA and Police Scotland must collectively provide stronger leadership. Who's ultimately responsible for providing that leadership?
As I've said to the committee, in formal terms, the accountable officer is the chief executive of the SPA, accountable to Parliament for the use of resources by SPA and Police Scotland. But the structure we have in place with the Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland means that there needs to be real clarity about who's responsible for what, how they work together, and how that enables the accountable officer to fulfil his responsibilities.
This seemed to be the same problem we had before.
The changes that were put in place after my November 2013 report, I think, represented a movement in the right direction. But it's clear from what we've seen in our audit work and the financial pressures which policing in Scotland is facing that they haven't had the desired effect yet. I think that's very much one of the impetuses behind the governance review, which the Cabinet Secretary has asked the new chair of the SPA to carry out.
Now, in paragraph 8... we're talking about the introduction of this single fixed asset register, Asset 4000. Clearly, this process has not been completed, you know, in terms of your audit report. Is Asset 4000 going to be the answer?
Jill,
will it do the job?
I'm happy to respond to that. We are familiar with Asset 4000 from other audits we have covered with large public sector bodies across Scotland. But it was going to be a very significant exercise in order to implement it. And so it was the project to implement it that took an extended period of time, and they did not have time to carry out the necessary quality reviews before the external audit team came along and found a number of challenges and problems with the integrity of the data that was there.
Is on paper at least the information, has it been input into Asset 4000 and they're just now working through any discrepancies? Would that be correct?
Yes, and in fact, that's what was happening at the time of the audit.
Thank you.
Yes, I'd like to understand the structures because we are now into our third year. And if we haven't got the structures right now, I think the committee is trying to suggest that, you know, we haven't got it right now. Are we actually going to get it right? So there are two directors of finance. There's now another interim chief finance officer been appointed, director of finance and SPA, director of finance in the public, in the police authority, in the police Scotland itself. There's also an audit committee for the police authority. Is there something similar in Police Scotland? No, just the one. Just the one. I see that Gillian is nodding. That. Are you satisfied that the governance the general structure, is now right, or should there be a permanent chief finance officer over the two directors of finance?
I'll preface very briefly, Dr. Simpson, by saying we are aware that the Cabinet Secretary has asked for a governance review to look at exactly these sorts of questions, and then ask Jill to give you her professional view on what's working at the moment and what might be needed in future.
Say whether you're being consulted about that, because it seems to me your input from the experience of doing an audit with different finance officers, different interim chief, whatever it is, you know, you've got the continuity, which doesn't seem to be there.
Certainly, as part of our annual audit each year, we produce a number of reports and we have made a number of recommendations with respect to the finance functions for the two organisations. And indeed, yesterday I had colleagues from the audit team meeting with officers to see how they were implementing those recommendations. And throughout this process, those recommendations are intended to improve, clearly, the structures and processes that are in place to make them more effective. We welcome that a governance review is being conducted, and we have been consulted as a key stakeholder for that governance review at this stage, both in writing and in meetings with the team that are supporting the chair of the Scottish Police Authority in undertaking that governance review. I think in terms of our proximity to the two clients and what's going to be the right structure for going forward, there's no doubt that there has to be an understanding and a will and a shared ownership for the financial accounts, which after all is the reporting in public of the financial performance of the Scottish Police Authority, including the results of Police Scotland. And we feel it's a leadership issue in order to ensure there's that ownership, that quality and that professionalism in order to have a satisfactory outcome each year with the preparation of the financial accounts.
And that leadership has to come from the new chair and the new chief constable, presumably. That's very helpful. And I wonder if you could be willing to supply the committee with your observations so that the successor committee next year can hold to account the aspirations of the second set of aspirations that things are going to be right. Because if we can see your recommendations and then look at them in terms of the governance report and the changes that are made in the course of that, following that report, then this committee will have the opportunity to see whether 3 years on some progress is a little more speedy.
We can certainly provide the committee both with Jill's annual audit reports that set out her observations over the last 2 years and the response that we have made to the governance review about the issues that need to be addressed by the review.
I want to very briefly go back to the 21 million. Any organisation I've been involved in, and I've chaired charities, so that I'm aware of being the equivalent of the accountable officer, that when you receive funds that are, in charitable terms, we used to call them restricted. So you have unrestricted and restricted funds, and the restricted funds had to be used for the purpose for which they were authorised, and they had to be audited separately. So I just don't understand why an organisation as big as this, with presumably very well-paid finance people, don't actually have these as restricted funds that are clearly determined and not thrown into operational use. And I am very concerned that throwing them into operational use means that they will not have those funds in 2 years' time. And if it's simply being absorbed into the general running, then it won't be taken into account in determining future budgets.
There's no formal requirement for those funds to be restricted or treated separately or audited separately, but that's very much why in November 2013 I recommended that there should be transparency about how they were used. I think that concern remains a real one, a live one, because in the draft budget announced by the Deputy First Minister before Christmas, part of the additional funding for the SPA was a continuation of the reform funding of, I think, £55 million. And that clearly will go some way to helping to address the outstanding issues around police reform, but it's critically important that they aren't being used to underpin continuing expenditure, given that the financial sustainability is still an open question in the absence of a financial strategy.
Thank you for that. I mean, but it, should the government not have actually said that this is a restricted fund? They do it for charities. Third sector are held to account for much smaller sums. Should they not have said this is a restricted budget, you must not use it for general operational things, you must identify it?
It's not a common practice to place those formal restrictions on the way funding is provided, but it absolutely would be good practice in reform programmes where there's specific money being provided for a specific purpose to require clear reporting about how it's used. That's why I've highlighted the issue in my report.
Lastly, to paragraph 19, because going forward, I think that things are really very, very critical. I'm slightly surprised that in your report, because you know we do rely on Audit Scotland to give us a much broader view than simply the money. It's actually all about how the organisation is functioning. And the major problem for us in Parliament has been a question around the use of police officers, an expensive resource on which there are to be no compulsory redundancies, the use of that resource in an inappropriate way within call centres. And there have been significant complaints by the unions that the events of the M9 and those deaths were associated with the inappropriate use of poorly trained police officers, poorly trained in relation to the call centre function. And I'm slightly surprised in your report that you haven't addressed the inefficiencies that are there as a result of the requirement that compulsory redundancies can only apply to the poorer paid staff and not to the policemen, police officers. And in addition to that, although there aren't compulsory redundancies, there is anecdotal evidence that I've certainly had that senior police officers have been encouraged to take voluntary redundancy in order to reduce costs and bringing in much less experienced officers. And that seems to me to be very damaging in terms of the overall efficiency of the organisation if you're actually removing senior officers at a fast pace in order to replace them with junior officers who cost a lot less. There's no commentary on here on either of these two issues, and I wonder if you'd like to make a comment on them.
Certainly, Dr. Simpson. This report and the one that you considered 12 months ago are both produced under my powers under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Act, and they're very specifically on matters arising from the annual financial audit of the authority. My November 2013 report was produced under my other set of powers, Section 23, which is the powers under which I can look at the efficiency and the effectiveness with which money is spent. It's worth noting that this report was produced alongside the Chief Inspector of Constabulary's report, annual report on policing in Scotland for 2014-15, and his report focused on some of the issues that you're describing. And we will continue to work very closely together to make sure that our reports are complementary to each other as they were in this instance. Mark will be able to tell you a little bit more about the way in which we're staying close to the operational and value for money impact of the decisions that are being taken about staffing and other significant matters.
As the report says in paragraph 14, the SPA intends to produce its long-term workforce strategy by the end of this financial year, which we would expect to address some of the issues that you raise about the use of officers operating what have perhaps previously been more non-officer roles. One of the real challenges that SPA and Police Scotland faces, the large amount of their expenditure that falls within staff costs, as they've identified it in their statement of long-term financial intent. It's 86% of their total cost, of which the overwhelming majority is police officer costs. So given the other constraints that they have on them, they are relatively restricted in their action. But in terms of the operational impact that has, that very much falls within the realm of HMICS, who we work with very closely. We meet on a quarterly basis and coordinate our work and our engagement with SPA and Police Scotland.
That's very helpful. And just one small comment. It's interesting. You refer to the fact that crime is down by 41%, but of course it's down by 41% in England as well, where they've cut the number of officers very significantly. So police officer numbers are not actually the main driving factor in relation to the reduction in crime. It's a worldwide phenomenon in the developed countries. And I think that there is a complete myth around this, which is very damaging to this organisation going forward.
Shoot me, Mill.
Thank you, Convener. Just a couple of questions regarding the Asset 4000. But one of the things that struck me just reading this and also listening to the evidence earlier on this morning was regarding the timescales for the audit process that took place. But before I go into those questions, when we had the single forces beforehand, did they actually have their own asset registers, or did they populate the Asset 4000?
The previous forces all had their own fixed asset registers.
So in terms of this particular process and Asset 4000, when was the request to the SPA, when was that request put to SPA to start to undertake the inputting of the data into Asset 4000, and when did your audit process actually start in this particular instance as well, please?
So the SPA and Police Scotland came into existence for the first financial year 13-14, at which point one would expect progress to be made for pulling together key financial systems. We reported at the end of 13-14 that fixed asset registers not only had not been brought together as one, the individual ones had not been kept up to date during 13-14. So during 14-15, when they embarked upon pulling everything together into Asset 4000 as the one fixed asset register to the new national organisation, it was 2 years' worth of data that had to be drawn in, given the fact that the individual ones had not been maintained during 13-14. It's an absolutely normal part of the annual audit process to carry out audit work on the fixed asset register of an organisation. It would not be a request that we would place to them to progress with it. They clearly needed to progress with it for their own purposes. We would normally carry out interim audit work before the financial year end to carry out work on systems of internal control, and we would carry out audit work after the year end on the actual transactions and balances. For the year 14-15, we could not carry out any interim audit work on the new fixed asset register because the project was still underway, it was still a period of transition. And indeed, when it came to the final accounts audit, we could not commence our audit testing at the planned date. It started 6 weeks into the final accounts audit. And this was the reason for the protracted nature of the 14-15 account and the fact that we concluded it much later than intended.
So is it fair to say then that with the process that you have attempted to go through, because of the inherent legacy issues of the single forces and the fact that their asset registers themselves actually weren't up to date, then the situation that yourself has faced as the auditor, then it's made your job that bit tougher, and also the fact that you couldn't actually complete the audit process that you wanted to do.
Make a point of clarification on that point. At the time of the last year of the legacy forces, which was the year 12-13, they all received unqualified audit opinions on their financial statements. During the first year of the new organisation, 13-14, it would be very ambitious to have achieved one fixed asset register during the year 13-14. Consequently, as a compensating arrangement, you would have expected all of the legacy fixed asset registers to have been kept up to date, and that would have been the basis for our audit work for 13-14. However, that wasn't the case. So it's not a criticism associated with the period prior to 13-14, just to make that point clear.
No, it's. I wholeheartedly accept and agree with the point regarding the asset register that it should be up to date. So I'm not trying to dispute that point in any way, shape, or form, but I'm just trying to establish and understand exactly why yourself faced the issue that you did, and why the SPA haven't managed. Well, certainly, and their support didn't manage to. Get into that position of actually having that full up-to-date asset register. I'm trying to really kind of fully understand why that was the case.
Yes, there's no doubt that it was a big exercise over now 24 months to get one asset register that is accurate and up-to-date. There was certainly a project in place during 14-15 to do so, but it did not progress at the pace that was necessary for them to have achieved a good outcome by the conclusion of financial year 14-15. In terms of pushing me on the point as to why that's the case, it is a question that the two finance structures, it took time to put the right people in the right place in the two finance structures, but there was, so it was late that there were the assigned people to carry out the work. There was a project in place and different people were assigned roles to progress it, but they did it in quite a disparate fashion, and there was no one person taking ownership for the whole project at the end of the day, and there was a lack of quality review about the data that had been input, and consequently, when we carried out the audit work, we were the first to encounter a number of errors and problems and had to report that back to officers, which they then had to correct for.
So in terms of that particular finding, had the SPA utilised, was it internal staffing for this, or did they bring in external contractors to undertake this particular piece of work?
The work was largely taken forward by Police Scotland finance staff, and we have said in our long-form report to the Scottish Police Authority ourselves, to local level, that there was a failure of quality assurance over the work that was carried out there, and there was a failure of scrutiny by the Scottish Police Authority about the fixed asset records.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Auditor General. We've talked a lot about the systems. I'm wondering if I could just go to the real value of what's involved in that asset schedule. And just come back to a subject that I've asked about in other contexts. In other words, the real valuation of the assets, their saleability, whether indeed any of the assets is actually very much use to anybody else, whether their replacement costs are appropriately measured, whether any of the black hole in the future could actually be filled by selling assets. Buildings tend to be overvalued in practice. I think you know where I'm trying to go, Auditor General.
Yes, and you're absolutely right to ask the question. The reason why we've highlighted the failings in the asset register is not because we're being counted to get excited by those sorts of things, but because it should be a really important source of information for making exactly those decisions, and it could well be a source of savings which will help to make policing sustainable in future. I'll ask Jill to talk you through the way the valuation process works and how that ties into the questions that you've asked there.
The Scottish Police Authority does have accounting policies with respect to the valuation of its fixed assets, and as we've highlighted, the value of fixed assets is now running at some £500 million in the financial statements of the organisations. A number of valuations were indeed carried out relating to the financial year 2014-15. However, they were carried out very late in the day, and a number of accounting entries were made after the year end in connection with those assets. For certain ones, there were impairments in value, and those are recognised in the 2014-15 accounts. This is another area, though, where there was a number of errors made in the accounting entries after the valuations were processed, and this is, again, where the external audit team had to engage with key members of staff for correcting entries after the valuation of assets. But we are comfortable that the organisations are up to date with their own accounting policies for the valuation of land and property, land and buildings.
So does that imply that you are comfortable that they have up to date with the replacement cost or the upgrading cost of the assets that they need in the long term?
We are content that they are, comply with their accounting policies. On occasions, that's a depreciated replacement cost value. On other times, that's an existing use value. And we're content with the arrangements they put in place, and they used external experts for those valuation exercises.
Can I go beyond that, though? I appreciate that auditing is about asking yourself whether things are consistent with an accounting policy. Been there, done that. I guess my question to the Auditor General is, does the accounting policy actually fit the task of having a police force which is going to be able to do its job this year, next year, 5 years, 10 years? This isn't a business that's going out of business. This is a business that's got to be able to operate forever and ever.
Right. First of all, that's why the asset register is so important, and then I'd link it back to the financial strategy. One of the underpinning strategies is around property and other major fixed assets. It's clear that bringing together 8 regional police services into 1 national police service may bring the opportunity to dispose of some assets, to sell them, potentially to invest in others, to have better, more fit for purpose buildings and assets on which to deliver the service. But without having both an up-to-date asset register and a financial strategy, it's not possible to do that. In some instances, that might mean a change in the valuation basis. If you decide you don't want this police station anymore, you want to dispose of it and invest in something else, then your valuation base may well change to something which is more appropriate for assets that are held for disposal. But you need the information to be in place to be able to make those decisions and to make and to account for them to this committee and to the public effectively.
Point then, convener, would be, are you confident that those who are making these judgments understand what you have just said about changing the basis of valuation to fit the need? Clearly they've got to have an asset register, they've got to have up-to-date valuations. I've no problem about that. If they haven't got them, they haven't got the basic information. But are you confident that the management structure at the moment and the people involved is actually able to take account of the need to have the right accounting system and the right accounting protocols in such a way that we do have a long-term Police Scotland?
Jill may have a comment on this. My view is that people will almost certainly understand that in principle, but it's not until you start doing the work of the underpinning asset strategy and the decision-making that comes from it that becomes something that people are doing in practice and understand the implications of. In a sense, you can only do it in practice as you're starting to think about the choices you're making.
Thank you, convener. Obviously, and happy new year to you all as well. Obviously, there was a standoff when the setup was happening in Police Scotland about VAT. And I noticed that you mentioned it in paragraph 11. Allowing for the fact that there was no agreement and the Scottish force has to, and is the only force that has to pay VAT, one thing I'm a little bit unclear of is how much they are actually paying.
Can I ask you to pick that one up?
Off the top of my head, I can't remember exactly what the VAT liability was in 14-15. I don't know whether Jill has the number to hand from the accounts.
I would say it's in the region of 20 to 23 million, but we can confirm that.
Another question that has been buzzing around for a little while is the way the pension scheme is set. Would I be correct in saying that the pension scheme is a UK-wide scheme?
I can respond to that. In the annual accounts, there is a separate set of accounts for the police pension scheme, and it is a Scottish... The nature of the scheme is that it's similar throughout the United Kingdom, but there is a set of annual accounts specific to the Scottish police pension scheme, and it's associated just with officers, and it is in the annual accounts.
Right, OK. So one of the questions that I've heard asked in the past was the liabilities, particularly from the days of the from the legacy forces. Seems I'm in some doubt as to whether or not these were a part of, although audited in terms of Scotland, it was a UK-wide scheme. Is that correct?
So this the Police pension scheme in Scotland is an unfunded scheme, and that is similar to the National Health Service and the Scottish Teachers Superannuation Scheme. It was clearly going to be a step change when the eight forces merged together. And for the year 13-14, seeing that unfunded liability for the first time, it was a figure of £12 billion. This year, for the year 14-15, the unfunded liability altogether in the accounts is now £15 billion. So that is a 20% increase in the liability. Unlike the NHS and the Scottish Teachers Superannuation Scheme that are underpinned by Westminster, this scheme is specific to Scotland.
Could I just clarify then that this is simply since Police Scotland started to exist, the legacy forces were completely separate as well, is that correct?
The legacy forces all had a pension liability. So if you were to add up the eight up until the year 12-13, it would be a figure similar to what the aggregated figure was when the new merged force came into being in 13-14. So there's not been any change to the scheme. It's just that it's one set of accounts now shown within the Scottish Police Authority's accounts. Mm-hmm.
But was that always separate from, say, the forces in a pension scheme in England and Wales, is what I'm trying to...
Yes.
Right, that's fine. Okay.
Just before we finish, just ask a couple of questions in connection with the... In the report, you referred to the constraints and some of the challenges that face the future of the SPA, and one of them is particularly in relation to a non-compulsory redundancy policy. Do you think that's sustainable?
The legislation that governs my role, convener, specifically prevents me from commenting on the merits of policy. What I said in my report in November 2013, though, was that both the no compulsory redundancy policy and the 17234 officer commitment reduce the flexibility that the SPA and Police Scotland have in balancing their finances and future. That's a statement of fact which remains true.
Okay. Could you just ask finally, in terms of the asset register, and the fact that some of the information hasn't been recorded as part of the asset process, what examples could we be referring to that haven't been registered? So when we I know when we talk about assets, we can mean buildings, you know, plant, but could you give me some examples of, I mean, have there been buildings that within the assets that haven't been registered anywhere that maybe the Police Scotland weren't aware that were even existed? Or
so by the conclusion of the audit, we were satisfied as to the adequacy of the accounting records by when we finished the audit on December the 3rd. But prior to then, we did find problems with the accounting records. Sometimes it was due to the actual figures that had been drawn in. Sometimes we found that depreciation charges hadn't been included. Sometimes we found there were elements that had been capitalised that ought not to have been included in the fixed asset register.
I don't know, a station or something that was no longer in operation but had not been recorded, or was there something significant?
No, there weren't big items of land and buildings that had been overlooked in the way you suggest. We did find problems with including movements in the valuation of the land and buildings, but not big omissions such as you suggest.
Okay, thank you. Okay, I thank the Auditor General for that report, and the can I just say we'll go into a brief 5-minute suspension? Can we convene, colleagues? Can I now move to agenda item number three, which is evidence on the AGS report entitled Health and Social Integration. I'd like to welcome once again the Auditor General, Carolyn Gardner, Claire Sweeney, the Senior Manager, and Rebecca Smallwood, who's the Performance Auditor, and Gordon Neill, who's the Portfolio Manager. I understand the Auditor General would like to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. As you know, the Public Bodies Joint Working Scotland Act set out a framework for NHS boards and councils to integrate some of their health and social care services. This is an ambitious programme of reform, which will, in time, affect most people who use health and social care services. The Act creates 31 new partnerships, known as integration authorities, across Scotland, one for each council area, and a joint authority between Clackmannanshire and Stirling councils. These integration authorities must have delegated responsibility for budgets and services by April of this year. The report I bring to you today looks at progress being made in advance of this deadline. It's the first of a planned series of three reports, and it's also related to my annual overview reports on the NHS and my forthcoming report on changing models of health and social care. The scale of reform brought in by the Act is very significant, covering services with budgets of over £8 billion a year that affect the lives of people right across Scotland every day. We found widespread support for the principles of integration from those involved with implementing the changes. All 31 integration authorities are expected to be operational by the deadline of 1 April 2016. Despite this progress, there are some significant risks that need to be addressed if integration is going to fundamentally change how health and social care services are delivered. We found evidence that integration authorities might not be in a position to make a major impact in 2016-17. In particular, difficulties in agreeing budgets and uncertainty over longer-term funding mean that comprehensive strategic plans are not yet in place. The report also highlights other important issues. For example, the complexity of governance arrangements means it will be hard for staff and people who use services to be clear about who's responsible for care. Workforce issues are also significant. There is a risk of inheriting a workforce that's been organised in response to budget pressures as opposed to strategic needs, and there are risks around the different terms and conditions for NHS and council staff and problems with recruiting and retaining GPs. We make a number of recommendations in the report. These are intended to address the risks that we've highlighted to develop integration before the 1st of April deadline. For example, we recommend that integration authorities should be clear about how governance arrangements will work in practice, particularly when disagreements arise. This would include clear statements on the roles and responsibilities of the integration authority and its individual members, the council and the NHS board, and also ensuring that the members of the authorities receive training to prepare them for their roles. This will help to minimise the risk of confusing lines of accountability and potential conflicts of interest, as well as making clear who's ultimately responsible for the care provided. As always, Convener, my colleagues and I will do our best to answer the committee's questions.
OK, I'll go straight to Richard Simpson.
Yes, I think it's a very useful first report. Mary Scannon and I have been around long enough to have experienced the Joint Futures Programme in 2001, which failed effectively. I'm interested particularly in the budgetary side of it, because it seems to me if that's wrong, then you know there's going to be major problems. And all the anecdotal stuff that I'm hearing are that these joint boards are likely to start with the possibility of absolutely huge deficits if they're going to carry out their functions. The budgets, of course, have to be approved by the government, by the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing. Those budgets have to be in place, as I understand it, by April, have to be approved by April. Are you satisfied with the progress that's being made in approving those budgets? Because without them, we're really not going to get very far. And is it likely that those budgets will be more than the budget for 2016-17, because your report on the health service has been critical about the failure to have long-term planning rather than year-to-year planning, and here we're going into a new setup which doesn't even have a year's plan.
We highlighted outline in the report the importance of getting both next year's budget and the strategic financial plan in place for the longer term for exactly the reasons that you're highlighting, Dr. Simpson, and it's one of the things which is not yet in place. As you say, we know that both health boards and council social care services are already under significant financial pressures, both because of the pressures on the finances for public services more generally and the demographic pressures that they're facing, and that will make it more challenging. That's one of the reasons why having the budgets in place and having governance arrangements that will be clear about how the budgets are used is so key, and those are the two key things I think we're highlighting in this report. I'll ask Claire to talk you through a bit more about what we know about the progress that's being made and our sense of optimism or otherwise about the chance of having it in place in the way that you described by April.
Thank you. Yes, we recognise in the report that it's been very challenging for partnerships to get this far. As you know, this is the first in three reports we plan to carry out an integration. So we're looking at the very early stages of them getting arrangements in place before they actually begin the work, as it were. What we've seen so far is that the schemes were signed off and approved by ministers in line with the timescales that were anticipated. The intention is that all budgets will be in place by the 1st of April. We understand and highlight in the report that there are risks and challenges around this. We observed a number of difficulties in negotiating those relationships between partners in various places across the country. But at the moment, we think it's likely the budgets will be in place on time. That's not to underplay the difficulty in the discussions that are going on at the moment about things like, for example, which parts of the acute budgets for hospitals will be included within the new arrangements. There are clearly substantially difficult conversations taking place to enable the partnerships to be in a place to get on with the job as at the 1st of April.
In 2008-09, the Integrated Resources Framework System was beginning to be set up. I understand it's got a new name, but effectively that was the background information that should have been providing information leading up to integration. We're 7 years on from that, and I'm disappointed that in paragraph, I think it's around 89-90, you actually say that the data sharing arrangements are not yet in place. And that surprises me because, you know, that integrated resources framework should have been providing that information by now in considerable detail. I know there were difficulties at a local level initially, but, you know, it should have been evolving. Has that not been adequately resourced by the government? What's been the failure by government to provide this anticipatory information?
Well, we've been tracking the developments of the Integrated Resource Framework for a number of years and absolutely identified in this report and previous reports that kind of information is central to making a success of the changes. What we've observed over the years is that has moved from that developmental approach tested out in various areas to a much more systematic approach now, where that information is collected centrally and is reported out to all partnerships. So, for example, one of the big, more recent developments has been the government supplying the information to partnerships around people who are high users of NHS and social care services. We've had some really helpful conversations with various partnerships across Scotland, thinking particularly in Tayside, where they're using very detailed information based on the centrally held data, bringing together health and social care information to give a much more rounded understanding about what the real challenges are, to get beyond some of the high-level national stats, to think, what does this mean for individuals living on a particular street or people who really do need to access health and care services on a regular basis? So we are seeing a move forward and a support to partnerships so they do have the information they need. But you're right, there are still significant areas of development that need to be addressed very quickly if partnerships are to really make the difference that the vision of integration was intending.
You're satisfied the government through the ISD are now providing this information to an adequate level to allow the outcome stuff which you refer to be actually looked at appropriately?
Partnerships have better information now than they've had before in terms of making those decisions locally. What we're also seeing, and the Auditor General's made a reference to a report we're
currently working on around models of health and social care. And what we'll do within that report is get under the skin of some of those national data sets and bring forward examples of local partnership working where they have brought data together locally, overcome the challenges that we mentioned in this report, and started to focus on exactly where the pressure points are across the health and social care systems. So we have seen that develop over time. It's big and it's challenging, but the information is there to a quality that it wasn't before.
The other aspect of this is, of course, the national care standards, because unless you know what standards you're applying, then the whole thing becomes really rather irrelevant. And those haven't been modified since 2002. The Health and Sport Committee called on the government in 2012 to produce new care standards. And as far as I know, we still haven't got them, unless you know differently. So here we are going into the most significant reform since 1948. In the health service and social care service, and we don't have national care standards against which to set it. Is this not a, maybe it's a policy issue you can't comment on, but it seems to me to be something that without that data, both the integrated resources framework or whatever it's now called, and the national care standards, then, you know, these new organizations are really fighting an uphill battle to get the sort of governance arrangements in place they need.
To the national care standards in paragraph 92 of the report, and there's currently a consultation underway about the overarching principles that should apply to the new standards. The government's plan is that the standards themselves will then be in place sometime during 2017. So work is underway, but you're right, they're not yet in place in a refreshed way since the original ones from 2002.
So how is the successor committee to this committee and the Health and Sport Committee going to be able to hold the IAs to account against a set of standards that are now 14, 15, or going to be 15 years out of date?
I think that's a question that's better directed to the government than to
Thank
us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mira.
Well, General, clearly this report highlights the fact there are significant challenges in what is a very major and ambitious project. I'm looking at paragraph 35 on page 19, and I'm looking at your comments about the guidance provided by government, and that three Ayrshire IGBs have sort of gone ahead in advance of that guidance. What are the implications for that?
You through the implications in more detail. I think the point we're making here is that some of the guidance was later than would have been ideal for the partnerships to be able to use it. Claire, can you pick up what that means for the partnerships that did go ahead before the guidance was available?
Thank you. The characteristic of how the reforms have developed to date has been an awful lot of consultation and an awful lot of engagement with the partners involved. In a sense, what we've been reporting on over the last few years is a building of similar issues. So in a sense, a lot of this was not new. Partnerships were already working towards some of the core standards that have been set nationally around keeping people safer in their own homes. So they were very familiar with a lot of the reporting that was already in place. I think one of the challenges around the guidance coming later means that partnerships did start off from a place without having that guidance in place. The consultation that's ongoing, and they will continue to have discussions around performance reporting as they understand that that's still happening, has been helpful, but it does mean that some partnerships went a little bit earlier in terms of publishing some of the information, and there is a risk that doesn't fall in line with the guidance. I would say the overall ambition is common across all partnerships. They understand the core aims of the reforms are about keeping people safer at home, a general shift away from unplanned emergency admissions to better care in the community, and all that entails for GP services, for community services. So there is an understanding about the general approach that everybody's aiming towards, but there is a risk that the guidance came later for some partnerships than would have been ideal.
Given the fact that there seems to be a common understanding of the approach and so on, in paragraph 42, it says the scope of the services being integrated varies widely across Scotland. Why is that?
The reforms were designed to allow for local flexibility to address local issues. So we would expect to see quite a lot of variation in terms of the some of the particular measures that are being used at a very detailed level, some of the services that have been integrated. So, for example, if a particular local area had a problem with drug and alcohol services, you might expect to see much more being talked about and a much greater focus from the resources, the money, the staff, the initiatives to improve some of the performance around drug and alcohol services than perhaps in an area that had that less of a priority for them. So that's fine and that's right, but what we recognise in the report is that there are inherent challenges with that, in having a focus on outcomes at a very local level, which drives the entire system. That's fine, but there is a real challenge in tying that up with what we know nationally about what works well, sharing good practice, and a general oversight about how the system's performing across health and social care services. So there are real challenges in there for the partnerships and for government to work through.
So you expect to see these variations locally. In the same paragraph, you're saying there's a risk of fragmented services in some area. But fragmented services are a wee bit different from just having local variations.
Right. One of the things we're concerned about there, and we've highlighted in the report, is a risk that there is a focus on reform of those services that are included with integration, and that there's a separation or a different direction of travel for those services that fall out with the integrated partnership arrangements. So one of the things we've highlighted as very important is establishing those very clear senses of good care and clinical governance, that there's real clarity about who is responsible for delivering what services, and crucially, that people within the local areas really understand what's entailed in all of this, you know, in what way will their services change and improve, and that their voices are heard as much as the professions that play a key role.
Well, I understand that there has to be local variations because, you know, there are different priorities in different areas, and I understand that. But a lot of the core elements of this should be common. What I'm thinking is, how are we going to actually measure the success of these bodies if there are no common indicators there?
And there will be core indicators in the sense that there will still be a series of national measures and targets. They will still exist, although they will shift and change over time. There will be the 9 national outcome measures that we've detailed in the report. Those are key to looking across the entire system and seeing what impact the changes and the reforms are having. So in a sense, those are the twin tracks that will give you that national picture about how the reforms are having an effect locally.
Ms. Cameron?
Can I just ask a supplementary in response to Richard Simpson's point about, you've got in paragraph 73 that out of the 31 authorities, only 6 had agreed budgets by October. Given that we're now into January, what progress has been made on that figure?
Things have improved. There are ongoing discussions. I'm not able to give you an exact number about how many have budgets in place. We looked at progress as up to October last year, so we'll keep in touch as things develop. It's something through the local financial audit work as much as the national value for money work we'll want to keep a close eye on.
I wondered if you had an updated figure. I remember well Richard Simpson and I sitting on the first Health Committee when we put through the Health and Community Care, which brought forward the policy of free personal care. And at that time, we had thousands of what we call bed blockers, delayed discharge. And the reason the NHS couldn't get them out because they had to wait till the end of the financial year until the councils had money. Now, at that time, I remember clearly that every ounce of evidence that we had said there should be a single budget. What the committee didn't agree on was, or what we didn't recommend was who should hold that budget. But a single budget was agreed. We moved on to pooled budgets and aligned budgets. Now, on page 30 and 31, you're now talking about set-aside budgets and different planning cycles. What I would like to ask, when you say 31 out of 32 authorities, the 32nd one, of course, is Highland, NHS Highland and Highland Council. Now, they have this lead authority model. Now, I appreciate that the Scottish Government hasn't recommended one particular model, but I've got quite a lot of experience of that model, and I'm now able, if someone comes and says my mum's in Raigmore Hospital, and you know what, I know exactly who to go to. There's no passing the buck or passing the budget. Should we not be a bit more robust? I mean, in 2001, we are asking health, NHS and the councils to work together. 15 years later, the Scottish Government, and I support them, because of this unwillingness to work together, I've actually had to bring forward legislation to get people to talk together. Now, we find that it's difficult to agree budgets. Is it the case that the NHS are still, allegedly, hiding behind patient confidentiality in the case that they're not willing to share information, a point that Richard Simpson brought forward? But what I'm really saying is, legislation enough to say, let's have integrated authorities? We've seen by this report that they can't agree. Should we actually go a step further and say the Highland model is the type of model where we need one budget, one responsibility, one accountable officer, instead of this trying to sit round the table and not be able to come to an agreement? We've had Highland in place for a while now, and I think it's perhaps a good model.
I recognise the sense of frustration about the slow progress that's made in this very difficult area. There's no doubt that it is difficult. In Exhibit 2 on page 11 of the report, we give a brief history of integration of these services in Scotland, and it's a long list of initiatives leading up to the 2014 Act. I think it's important to say there are some things that are different now. There is, for the first time, a statutory requirement to have a shared budget and shared resources. In the past, that wasn't a statutory requirement. It's something that was encouraged. There is a requirement to focus on the outcome measures rather than on activity and the sorts of things that might come in before. And there is, I think, very importantly, this requirement for the people who use these services to be involved in designing their own care for the first time. So all of those are new things that come with the legislation. Having said that, your question about whether legislation is enough to make it work in practice, in my view, it's never enough. Legislation can provide a very useful underpinning, but it does require people to be willing to work together for some give and take, for a genuine commitment to shared planning for the benefit of the people who use these services, and in time that will be all of us. The question about whether everyone should be following the Highland route, I think, is one that we can't answer. The legislation clearly provides for the two different models. I think it's very interesting that everywhere except Highland is going for the integration joint board approach rather than the lead agency approach. We are continuing to watch with interest how all of this plays out in practice. I said in my introductory remarks that this is the first of a series of three reports we plan to produce as the legislation is fully implemented. And in a sense, I hope that we'll be able to answer exactly that question as that work progresses, about which model is better, and within the 31 integration joint boards that we're seeing, which of those are having the most impact on changing things for people.
Right, just my final question, Convener. Given that the NHS budget has been largely protected, although we know there's been efficiency savings, etc., but it's been largely protected in comparison to the huge challenges that we read day by day in local authorities and the savings that they have to make. So, you know, given the pressure on councils and perhaps not quite so much pressure on the NHS, is that leading to difficulties in agreeing budgets? And can I just throw in this point? Back in 1999, 2000, etc., we were always told there were cultural differences between the NHS and, say, social work, that didn't really understand each other and they spoke different languages and different jargon. Is that still an obstacle to making this work? Just those two points.
Sure. I'll ask Gordon to come in a moment on both points. I'll just kick off by saying that one of the risks we highlight in here is the risk that not only are councils and health boards trying to do this at a time of tight finances and rising pressures, but exactly as you say, because of the additional pressure on councils, they have responded, understandably, by reducing staff numbers and outsourcing large numbers of care staff. And that does raise a risk that the staff that the new integration authority
entities inherit aren't designed around how you would best deliver joined up services. They're designed around how people have been managing against the background of the pressures they've been facing over a period, and that will be a challenge for the authorities. There are also, as we know, different terms and conditions in a range of ways that can make that more tricky. Gordon, would you like to add to that in terms of what you've seen in cultural differences as well as staffing differences?
There are. You're right to suggest that the NHS has had relatively protected status. It's been a policy decision for a number of years. And social work has had to compete against other council services. So certainly amongst the people involved in the integration authorities, there is at least a perception that the NHS side of the integration authorities will have more protected status. And there is a concern, again, a perception, we have to see how that will pan out in the future, but a perception that social work staff might be more at risk if the shape of the workforce has to change in future years. There's a perception it's easier to downsize the social work side than the NHS side. There are cultural differences that do come through. You can see it already. There's the obvious ones. There's the politics. Local authorities are very political animals. The very local, the clue's in the name. So they have a different perspective. There's also more subtleties in that local authorities are more used to outsourcing, more used to using the private sector. So about a quarter of care staff come from the private sector, whereas that's not the case in the NHS. So there are cultural differences that will have a profound impact.
Sorry, Convener, can I just say on that point, and you do mention the voluntary sector quite a bit as well as the private sector, is there potentially a risk to that outsourcing to the voluntary sector organisations like Crossroads and others who have provided excellent care over many decades? Is there a risk to that, given that the NHS is perhaps not as accustomed to outsourcing work now that they're sitting with the budgets as well?
There is a risk of that. Certainly we've had a fair bit of contact with the voluntary sector as we're doing this work. Now, it's still relatively early days, but certainly from some of the voluntary sector people that we spoke with, they didn't feel they were being engaged enough at locality level in the strategic planning. So certainly from their perception, there's a risk that they're getting excluded at the moment, that it's seen as an NHS local government agenda.
Thank you. Can I just ask about the points you make on GPs and GP recruitment? In 86 and 87, you specifically mentioned the concerns about workforce planning in terms of delivering integrated care, given the shortage of GPs we have. Just how significant is that? How much of a danger is that problem?
GPs, we know, are central to getting health and social care well integrated and making sure that people are kept safe and healthy in their own homes. They're key to avoiding unnecessary admissions, making sure that people who are vulnerable in different ways get the care they need at home and that it responds to their changing needs. And they're key to getting people safely discharged if they do need to go into hospital. We've reported elsewhere on the pressures on the GP workforce, particularly in my annual overview report of the health service. We think it's a significant enough issue that we're planning some more work specifically on workforce in the health service, and GPs will be a key part of it. I'm not sure there's much more we can do to quantify that just now, but we do identify it as a risk for exactly those reasons.
No, I'm sure that's very fair. You say at the bottom of 87 that it will be many years before the measures will have a significant impact, the measures being the government's interventions in order to try and tackle GP recruitment shortage. I mean, if it's many years, this thing's meant to be up and running now, and that suggests there's a fundamental issue between the availability of full-time permanent GP staff right across Scotland, it's not just my part of the world, it's right across the country, and the practical implementation of this policy. That sounds to me like quite a big problem.
It would be a challenge whether this policy were in place or not. We know that GP recruitment and retention is a problem for a whole range of reasons, and it's not one for which there's a quick fix.
Yeah, a really significant issue there.
Absolutely.
For them. Yeah. Okay. Many thanks.
Chairman McMillan.
Thank you. In paragraph 26 and also paragraph 27, you highlight the scrutiny element of the IGBs. Previously, I was on the local government committee, and one of the things that, that came up there, and which also Audit Scotland have produced reports on, is regarding the benchmarking tool. In terms of the activities, well, the local government activities into these integrated joint boards, will they be covered under the benchmarking tool that's in operation?
I suspect they won't be a major part of the benchmarking operation other than in general terms through things like corporate support services. The benchmarking project is one that's now owned by local government and has made big strides because of that. The primary means for benchmarking this policy is the 9 outcomes and the supporting performance indicators that we outline in the report, and I think they're very much more focused on the quality of care that people receive and their experience and the experience of staff involved in the services. So the benchmarking project may be able to make a contribution, but I think it'll be at the margins.
Oh, that's helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Can I just pick up on the same aspect as I mentioned under the previous item? Are you confident, Auditor General, that the asset registers and all the substantial, very substantial capital assets are going to be properly assessed and valued and managed in all of this? Because I'm conscious that local authorities and the health service are trying to fill some of their financial gaps by selling some of those land and assets?
We know through the annual audit process that the asset registers of the 32 councils and the 14 territorial health boards are fit for purpose at the moment, with the very occasional exception. There is a question about how far those assets will be transferred into the integration authorities. They may well continue to be held by the health boards and councils, and the question then comes up about who's accountable for the decision making around them and whether there may be conflicts of interest for the members of the authorities. Claire, do you want to say any more about that?
Yeah, what we see very strongly in the report is that there needs to be very clear systems in place to be very explicit about who is responsible for what. In a sense, looking at the reforms at this very early stage, we were able to make recommendations about some of the risks we were seeing coming through. In a sense, until we look at the go live, until the financial audit starts, until we start to see how the partnerships are operating in practice, we don't have that level of detail yet. And what we were advocating very strongly in this report is the need for that to be very, very clear from the outset. So that's something we'll continue to look at as the partnership arrangements develop.
Thank you. I think come back to that just a moment. I'm wondering whether I could then take us to another subject dear to this committee, which is IT systems. Presumably, if there are 31 integration joint boards, there are potentially 31 IT systems, all of which will be separately maintained, reprocured, won't talk to each other. Am I being too cynical? Is there any prospect that any of this will be integrated?
I think you're absolutely right to flag the concern. Our expectation is that to start with, the authorities will continue to use the systems that are in place within the councils and the health boards for managing care services and health services. Over time, if an integration happens, there will certainly be a real push to have much more integrated and fit-for-purpose information systems that move on from there. I think it's too early for us to see that being a priority for any of the integration authorities that we've looked at, but it's very much on our risk register for something we want to keep abreast of.
There is a real risk that because there are fewer health boards than there are local authorities, that a health board will actually find it's trying to interrogate 2, 3 or possibly 4 local authority systems, all of which are different.
And in a sense, they're already doing that, not directly, but if you're working in the Royal Infirmary of Edinburgh and trying to arrange the discharge of an older patient with complex care needs, you'll have to be working with information and staff from 4 different councils at least before you start looking further afield. In some ways, I think bringing that to the fore through the integration authorities could be a positive, but it also does bring the risk, as you highlight, of attention being diverted into managing the challenges of an IT system rather than managing the care of the people involved.
Which leads me back to the issue of who's responsible for what and how we can see this going. I'm very conscious, again, the previous item on our agenda, we were talking about Scottish Police Authority and Police Scotland. Now, they are separate because the Chief Constable has to have operational independence, and we understand that. But we also recognise that it's caused some problems in
recent years. Surely we can see coming the same kind of problem, and this is not meant to be a comment on any individual person, when people at the head of the health service are trying to work with people at the head of the local authorities. I'm not telling anybody anything that isn't entirely obvious. I guess my question, Auditor General, is from what you're seeing, and I recognise you can't answer at policy level, but do we seem to have good models as to how that might work and good examples of how people can divide that up and still come to good decisions? Or are you looking at the same thing that I'm looking at, which seems to be the vast majority of cases prospectively a problem simply because people have split responsibilities?
We've tried in this report to highlight exactly that risk. I entirely understand the policy rationale for saying the answer to this isn't wholesale reorganisation, let's work with what we have, 14 health boards and 32 councils, and then putting the integration authorities in place to bring services together around the key groups of people affected. And as I say in the report, that brings complex governance arrangements, it brings with it a risk of unclear responsibilities, unclear accountabilities, and a risk of conflicts of interest. And it's why we're recommending at this stage, before they take on their operational responsibilities in 3 months' time, that those things really need to be pinned down. As you say, we've seen in the case of policing in Scotland the impact that that can have. These are another group of very significant public services spending lots of money affecting people's lives. I'm keen to see those arrangements clarified now to avoid the risk of those effects happening as these reforms roll out.
Am I therefore, this is the final one, expecting you to do something to audit those arrangements before we get too far down the road?
Again, that's why this is the first in a series of three planned reports, so that we can stay close to what's happening in practice.
We will come back to do stage two once the arrangements have been in operation for a full year. We have a further piece of work scheduled for the later to look in the longer term at what impact the reforms have had. So that's our plan in terms of the national performance audit work around that. Of course, there will be local audit work that happens as a routine throughout the process of the parent bodies, indeed, as much as the new arrangements once they're established. We also will have ongoing discussions with all parties involved as the reforms start to take effect. As the Auditor General has said, it's something we're clear is a big risk, and we want to stay very close to that.
Yeah.
Okay. So, Mr. General, can I just ask in conclusion, we've referred to the, and Mary Scanlon's referred to this in terms of, we have been looking at these partnership arrangements for a number of years, going way back. And I actually remember going back to even when I was a councillor in the late 90s, and there was the social inclusion partnerships, which is about local health boards forming partnerships with the local authorities. And even then, the tensions existed because effectively there was two budgets, the health budget and the local authority budgets, and those tensions continue. I can't see any evidence that those tensions in any way have allowed any progress to go forward, other than on the face of it, everyone presents a picture of partnership, but in practice there are significant tensions, and I know in different authorities it's been a significant challenge. I mean, if we had one budget for this process, and for example, I'm not asking you in the policy terms of this, but if, for example, local authority was responsible for healthcare, as we've seen happen in distant past, would that make it much easier to audit and ensure that it's taken forward? Because then we wouldn't have these two elements or two budgets by which these both authorities are responsible for.
As Mrs. Scanlon highlighted in her question, one of the options under the legislation is to have that lead agency model. In Highland, the council's responsible for all children's services, the health board is responsible for services for older people. Only Highland has chosen to go down that route, and I think it's an interesting question as to why that is. In the other 31 integration authorities, they will have to have a single budget for money and resources, staff and so on, which is a new development. That's never been a statutory requirement before in this long history of initiatives and approaches to trying to get integration. It may make a difference, and as you say, there are challenges and tensions there. We've tried to highlight the risks that we think need to be managed now before the 1st of April, and we will, as Claire said, continue over the next 12 months to look at what happens, but I can't give you any definitive answer about what we'll see in that work.
Just finally ask that you know, we talk about the public having confidence and we talk about transparency in these arrangements. I mean, I defy any member of the public to interrogate this and say, yeah, I really understand what's going on in the local health partnerships, because I think even for those who are well informed in this, I've been completely aware of what's in place locally is extremely challenging. And I think, most members of the public want to know how I access local services, and even that's a challenge because of these complex arrangements that have been put in place for various reasons. And does that not present a challenge as well in terms of these auditing how effective these organisations are being?
It is complex. I'd say if this works well, people will know how to access the services they need, and it shouldn't matter to them who's responsible at the end of the day for providing them. If what you need is available readily at the quality you need at the time you need it, that's what matters to most of us. The challenge is what happens if it doesn't work well, and particularly who is responsible in formal terms for the quality of care as well as for the money that's spent. That comes back to the recommendations we've made about clarifying that before the 1st of April, so everybody who relies on these services gets what they need.
Okay, I think Auditor General, just very brief.
You've already said GPs are fundamental to this. They were very disengaged from the community health partnerships. Have they all been abandoned now to be replaced by the integrated joint boards or integrated authorities?
Under the legislation, yes.
And that's happened, has it?
Yes.
What their staff, were they made redundant or...? Do we know? I mean, there are obviously costs involved in these reformations.
Yes, this wasn't a reform programme that's led to the redundancy of the staff involved. I think those staff are tending to be the people who are continuing to deliver services, and some of them will be moving into the integration authorities in terms of managing their responsibilities. But that's something we will be picking up in the next phase of this work.
Thank you. I thank the General for our briefing. Can we now move to agenda item number 4, which is the Section 22 report, the 2012-13 audit of North Glasgow College. Can I seek views from colleagues on the responses received? Colleagues, Mary Scanlon.
Could I just say, Convener, given that we've been looking at Coatbridge College and announcing our report today, there are some similarities between the issues at North Glasgow, in particular relating to Scottish Funding Council guidance. And I think given the work that we've done on Coatbridge and the wider college sector, and also the response we've received from Paul Johnson, I actually think that the work we've covered in Coatbridge covers many of the issues that were of concern at North Glasgow College, and I'm quite happy to leave it there.
Paul Beattie.
I don't really see where we can go on this from here. I would suggest we note it and agree with what Mary's saying, that this is really... It's in tandem with the Coatbridge issue, and I think, you know, the issues that SFC and the government are addressing here are very, very similar.
Davy Scott.
Yeah, I agree with my colleagues, but I just want to pick up the one bit of the answer from Lawrence Howells in the letter to the clerk from the Funding Council on severance payments. We still haven't had the full breakdown of that table we were promised in, gosh knows, I can't even remember when, November, October, sometime in the autumn. I really don't think it's acceptable for the Funding Council not to provide us with the information the committee's asked for, and I would, therefore, the only thing I'd add to Mary and Colin's points is that we should write formally to Lawrence Howells saying, give us the information.
Okay, I'll advise on that. Just the conclusion of colleagues' remarks. Nigel Dunn.
Yeah. Thank you, Mina. Can I just note, I think the fact that this has come through this committee has been highlighted to the government across several different colleges has actually gotten to the point of actually reflecting on how how some of this needs to be looked at. There is a task force sitting there looking at it, and I think we should recognise that that's been progressed by the committee, and as colleagues say, just leave it there for the moment.
Any other colleagues?
Mr. Howell's comments about his answer to our question about support and issuing guidance, etc., was extremely weak. And I thought, you know, if you used the word, I think I won't use it again when I've used in private, but I think that weakness really does give me concerns going forward as to whether this organisation is fit for purpose.
So can I just say, I mean, first of all, we have requested this information that Tavish Scott's referred to on a number of occasions, and we've asked for complete information. This isn't the first time, as convener of the committee, I've had to highlight the fact that information hasn't been received from the Scottish Funding Council. Once again, write to them and remind them of the importance of providing such information and how helpful it is for the committee to have that information so that it can carry out its responsibilities. I think you should reflect on that. And also, can I also support comments by Richard Simpson in respect of the responses from the Scottish Funding Council to advise that it didn't reissue the guidance, but only reminded the colleges of the guidance, given that they were processing over £53 million worth of public money as part of these severance arrangements. I think the reissuing of the guidance and not reminding them of the guidance would have been more effective. And it's simply not good enough now that the horse has bolted to say, well, we'll have a look at doing that in future. It was a serious failing in the part of the Scottish Funding Council. I think we've recognised that in our Court Bridge report. But again, for the Funding Council not to have carried out what would have been a pretty minimal task in terms of administration to simply remind the colleges of here is the copy of the guidance. It wouldn't have been beyond them, given the resources available to them to provide such information. So there's agreement then, colleagues, that we'll note this correspondence, taking into consideration the recommendations that we set out in the Court Bridge report. Is that agreed?
Thank you.
Thank you. And obviously we'll write to the Funding Council reminding them of the information that we required in respect to the table that was required. Okay. Colleagues, we move to agenda item number 5, which is the response from the Scottish Government to the AGS report entitled Efficiency of Prosecuting Criminal Cases Through the Sheriff Courts. Can I have comments, please? We have a number of options. We can note the correspondence we've received, or any further actions? Is it agreed that we should note the correspondence?
Agreed.
Okay, and as agreed previously, move to agenda item number 6, which is moving a committee into private session.